شكرا. Our next speaker is Dr. Nabil Al-Aqash. Nabil Al-Aqash is a consultant nephrologist, and he is currently the president of the Jordan Society of Nephrology, and was the director of the medical and nephrology department at the King Hussein Medical Center. His talk is going to be about new markers for acute kidney disease.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
And we'll remind you 2 minutes before your time. Thank you, okay, because you asked for it.
Thank you. Thank you for the introduction. Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, contrary to the progress and advances that have been achieved in nephrology over the years, acute kidney injury remains a major health care issue in medicine today. It's reported to occur in to develop in up to 30% of all admissions and in 10 to 90% of ICU admissions, and this large variation this different criteria used to define the condition. However, respective of definitions, the diagnosis of acute kidney injury is persistently associated with increase in both long and short prognosis, over short term of both short and term mortality and morbidity. A major obstacle for applying effective therapeutic interventions to combat acute injury has been the limited ability to diagnose renal injury in a significant renal injury in a timely manner. Serum creatinine has been the dominant biomarker or the dominant marker for renal function for more than 100 years now, but its use is limited, and its use is limited by different factors, non-renal factors such as race, gender, sex, and as well as factors like protein intake, drug metabolism, and hydration status. Further limitation to the use of serum creatinine has been the inevitable delay between the injury and the subsequent rise of serum creatinine. Consequently, by the time serum creatinine can detect acute kidney injury, the injury or the ascites injury can be many days old. So what I'm going to do with for the next 20 minutes is to review with you several or some important aspects of acute kidney injury, including its definition, the new applied criteria, dry fill, and the acute kidney injury network group definition, as well as to compare between the two definitions and the limitation for use, as well as to emphasize on the importance of acute diagnosis of early diagnosis of acute kidney injury, addressing some studies touching this, and also to find out on the evolving biomarkers, advantages and limitations. So what is acute kidney injury? As Professor Saeed has already mentioned, it's known as acute renal failure before. It's characterized by an abrupt, that is hours to days, decline kidney function, that is usually diagnosed based on either the evaluation of elevation serum creatinine and or detection of decreased urine production oliguria. It's associated obviously with significantly increased cost of care and substantial morbidity and mortality. Like for the ambulance order, 4 million, this is treatable, this is worldwide per year. Now, it is very common, it's harmful, and potentially treatable. Even a minor acute reduction has an adverse prognosis, and the early detection and treatment of acute kidney injury may improve outcomes. There are two similar definitions that are based on serum creatinine output, the rifle, and acute kidney injury network that have been proposed and validated. It is becoming in recent years with the use of consensus definitions for acute renal failure, the rifle and the acute kidney injury network group criteria is becoming more and more, it's adopted more by the clinicians. This is very important, and also it's a positive step in the right direction, although some remains variation in how the data are interpreted and used by the clinicians. In 2004, the Acute Dialysis Group initiative published its consistent definitions for acute injury, the RIFL criteria. This RIFL is intended to assist to establish the presence or absence of acute kidney injury syndrome and to assess its severity. it was not intended, however, to predict mortality or worse outcomes. Although it's logical to assume that the worst disease will result in worse outcomes. More recently, the graphical criteria were revised and by the acute kidney injury, by the acute kidney injury group. So, this is the acute kidney injury. It's based on serum creatinine. The RAFL is divided into a few stages of severity, from risk danger to failure, and these Belarusian stages of disease, depending on elevation serum creatinine and decrease in GFR by more than 25%. That is approximately within 1 to 7 days, and this should be sustained over 1 day. The injury stage is by 2 multiplied by 2, GFR is gone by more than 50% decreasing, and the failure also more significant elevation serum creatinine. These are the outcome criteria, and the urine output criteria are common to both the RAFL and acute kidney injury staging. It depends upon sustained decrease of urine output over 6 hours to 12 hours. The same basically acute kidney staging are stage 1 corresponds to the risk stage here, but it also emphasizes on that the increase should be within the first 48 hours. Stage 2 also by 200 to 300%, and stage 3 where a patient will need renal replacement therapy. These two stages were omitted from the AKI staging because probably they are aware of the outcome criteria. So we have to compare between the two conditions. It's said to improve the sensitivity and reproducibility of the RAFL criteria by incorporating an acute change in serum creatinine, and to establish a time constraint of 48 hours for the diagnosis of acute kidney injury. Stage 3 to include any patient receiving renal replacement therapy. And the RAFL criteria identifying and classifying 36% of all critically ill patients having acute kidney injury. The proposed modification increased the sensitivity of the RAFL risk category, however, shown significant difference in incidence or outcome. And this is a small study which was conducted in over 600 patients, ICU patients, where the RAFL category or acute kidney injury network included or allowed more patients in stage 1 at any stage as having acute kidney injury, but no difference in stage 2 or 3. And these are the limitation of the use of criteria, because any definition of acute kidney injury is its presence when has already been a decline in GFR. Whereas biomarkers, we are going to see in a minute, are able to make diagnosis at earlier stages. The use of the 6 to 12 hours criteria make a rifle and suitable for retrospective studies, since much data are not collected as part of routine clinical practice. And patients in the highest class, as divided by the serum creatinine criteria, were more severely ill than those in the same class as defined by urine output criteria. And the creatinine GFR criteria is based on changes from a baseline band, which is not always available. And finally, do not take into consideration the nature of the site of kidney injury. Well, this is an example of a critically ill patient who's likely to develop acute kidney injury. A 57-year-old was admitted in ICU because of ARDS and multi-organ failure. He has bilateral conflict infiltration, decreased urine output, and stable AVGs, and despite being on support. And this is the more classically traditional acute failure was divided into 3 stages, the prenatal and intrinsic, and the portion which is really appreciated, easily appreciated, that can be ruled out by cross-sectional examination. The prenatal was also classified to boost due to absolute or to relative decrease in blood volume, such as congestive heart failure or hemorrhage in this case, and also an arterial closure or stenosis of cholesterol emboli that follows usually with arteriographies, especially in the elderly people. High hemodynamic forms, very common nowadays due to increased much utilization of steroids, all the inhibitors or any other steroids. So in patients who are already susceptible, this is the ATI and variety, it can be due to vascular or acute GI or the crescent formation. Acute decision flights, drug use as an example, or acute family process that is due to nephrotoxic, that is either endogenously produced or administered exogenously. Now, this is to small cellulose conducted to utilize the pure sodium and between the deficient pre-renal and acute-renal failure, that's due to pre-renal with the utilizing therapy, and that's QTM, fraction excision sodium, this is the fraction of urea, this is the vein called diuretics pre-renal, this is the blue line of the pre-renal diuretics with CTM. It shows that the fraction excision of urea is similar among groups, irrespective of use or no use of diuretics, because its absorption depends upon osmotic forces. They conclude that the fraction excretion of urea below 33% is more sensitive and specific index than fraction excretion of sodium in differentiating between differentiating acute level that's due to renal causes or that due to established acute renal process, especially if they are severely utilized. And this is to assist the prevalence of acidosis. This study was taken from the hospitalized Medicare beneficiary group where more than 5.3 million discharge patients were included. And in overall, we estimated the standardized acute renal failure ratios raised annually by approximately 11% from 15 per 1,000 cases in 1992, almost 36 per 1,000 cases in 2001. And the rise was noted on patients who are having their primary diagnosis as acute failure, or it was secondary diagnosis with or without dialysis. And this is the curve, this Kaplan-Meier estimate, or the curves of community survivors by the and the study was taken in it's a cohort prospective study involving it was taken 7 ICUs and it involved more than 5,000 patients. It shows, according to the stage, that the more severe stage, there was the probability of survival. Here also, another study to show that acute kidney injury present and whether this factor is there were more than 1,400 patients in this study from 57 ICUs and in 16 countries. It shows that patients who develop acute renal failure they have lower probability of survival over the days. And here to show the crude hospitality, hospital mortality, this is a study. Was taken from Australia and was conducted over 120,000 patients and who were treated over 5 years period. And for each comparison between non-septic acute renal versus septic, there was significant difference. Also, the people acute renal crisis are not. Some of them will go and develop a stage of disease. But the nature of renal function in the remaining patients is not known. So certain this data were taken from United States Department of Veterans Affairs, where more than 60,000 patients were served as control, and the remaining patients have diagnostic code of acute kidney injury. It shows that in the kidney function is rated in all groups by time, but specifically in patients with acute renal failure and particularly patients with acute renal necrosis. Also saw that patients with ATN developed more easily, or more frequent went on to develop stage 4 chronic kidney disease. So the path of the surgery kidney injury is divided into several stages of severity, depending upon the inciting injury, from increased risk to damage, decreased GFR, kidney failure, and death. And various the traditionally used biomarkers like serum creatinine and blood urea are very much specific and coming late to compare and do not tell the severity of injury and also do not differentiate between different sites of injury. While those four biomarkers are start to raise as early as that stage of damage. So the usual diagnostic security which is of India, because security is the current goal now, standard, but it's problematic for the reason I already mentioned. And normal serum creatinine varies widely, as already mentioned also. In acute condition, serum creatinine can take several days to reach a new city space. And up to 50% of kidney functions may have lost before serum creatinine even begins to rise. So appreciating the difficulties of serum creatinine to diagnose acute kidney injury, the American Society of Nephrology in 2005 designated characterization, identification, and development of new acute kidney injury biomarkers for early diagnosis. So the utilities of biomarkers should have early diagnosis. They should also define the severity of injury. They should be able to define the subtypes of acute kidney injury and etiology, if possible. And also they should monitor response to acute kidney injury intervention. And they should risk stratify for poor outcomes, for deaths, for instance, and also to identify location of renal tubular injury, if possible. And this is the clinical clock that is always late, and it shows that there are different milestones that can be identified along the timeline between the injury, where it usually begins inducing molecular changes over there, and subsequently evolving into cellular damage, and then still starts to produce biomarkers. You can see that it takes about up to 24 hours before serum creatinine starts to be raised. And this is very interesting slide because while cardiologists have been identifying their diagnosis and diagnostic workup, from the 1960s they have used LDH as a key marker for myocardial injury, while we have serum creatinine. And then from the coming years, they've developed the CBK, the troponin, RTI, and then they had, because of the detection of these biomarkers, they had to implement multiple therapies. They achieved to produce 50% decrease in mortality, while nephrologists had the same almost diagnostic tool that serum creatinine over 150 years, and that we only put through supportive care or through high mortality. This is an ideal biomarker, should be according to this, the ROC, which probably is a statistical term, and the area under the curve, it shows that the case, the red one here over there, the curve yields is about 0.75, while that the blue one, which is considered a good biomarker. What the green one over the top here gives a range of 0.9, which is better, more good than the 0.75. And some of the characteristics of the ideal biomarkers that should be rapid and increase in response to injury. It's also should be highly sensitive for acute kidney injury. It has high dynamic and cutoff values, highly specific for acute kidney injury. Also, etiological specificity and should correlate with the injury of the severity of the injury at the level, also should provide prognostic information and applicable across range, a wide range of different populations. They also should be stable over different range of temperatures. They should be also easily measured in urine and or serum, and they should be also very expensive measurements. Or the level should be affected by drugs or other indigenous substances. These are some examples of the currently used in this under investigation biomarkers. This is the NGAD, the cancer urine and plasma, and gelatin, and this is the chemical in injury with fluid 1 in urine, liver fatty acid protein, binding protein, interleukin-18. Neuron system in C, plasma and urine. This is the glutamine or the glutathione as transferase, alpha and B, in urine, and this is glutamine transmutase and the beta 2 macrophage. There are many others, of course, tens of others. Probably these are the most important.
2 minutes, Nabil. Dr. Nabil, your time, 2 minutes.
Okay, this is the NGAD. molecule in gas, procedure taken from plasma, measured all from the urine. This is it. It looks like crystal structure of the gas. And this is in where after cardiac surgery, they start to, the gas start to raise 2 hours of cardiopulmonary fibers here. And this is after progress in dystrophy, also as early as 2 days. And even kidney transplant can be detected early. Cancer and creatinine, we have a small number of patients with this study, also it's very specific because the IgM by diagnostic group, but so creatinine was elevated in other conditions as well. Here also the abbreviated up to 15 folds in the first order of the polymerization indication to let the dose failure compared to solid bulk cell creatinine that structurized after the first 24 hours. Here also very this is showing immunohistochemistry staining on mouse kidney that is was subjected to ischemia, and it shows the uptake of pyrethrin by the direct expression of vingalbalet in the tubule. This is after 3 hours in the region, this is the control inside our team, and this is the source also can be measured in blood and urine. This is the sensitivity and the time of elevation were very earlier than just creatinine. Kidney measurement will also very specific one. Also, it can be seen increased in 6 to 12 hours after cardiac surgery in children with these figures. And the role of it's also both a small number of patients, it's mostly elevated in ischemic arterial necrosis compared to the other groups of acute injury. This is another one, and the biomarker leaking from 18 is also very important and can be elevated in after kidney transplant. This is the free fatty acid protein, but also can increase after kidney damage cystatin. And just two novel biomarkers, new ones, this from M and tissue secretors. They come together to state high or AAC or C, together also due to all the new biomarkers. And there is a panel of unifactor pattern that can increase the sensitivity, that's highly sensitive. And this is the accuracy of different biomarkers. So there are some of them, for instance, the Indian and the LFAB had higher accuracy early on the disease, at 24 hours, and it fades by time, while those of the regime 18 and KIM1, they have low accuracy, the area and they increase gradually. And this is where the site of injury can be presumed or assisted by the question from these exams. And this is some limitation of the two biomarkers. The diagnosis performance is variable from excellent to poor, not consistent generalizing conclusion can be drawn from the line condition like sepsis, diabetes, etc. And future directions, we should conduct probably large participant care to determine the effects of comorbid conditions, the accuracy and threshold biomarkers, like and utility, such acute biomarkers, independent of serum creatinine. And to conclude, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, acute kidney injury is a common and serious problem, especially in stroke patients, and associated with high morbidity and mortality. The diagnosis of creatinine is often delayed and lacks substantial predictive values. Error diagnosis may be essential to prevent further damage and clinical management, and novel biomarkers may be providing tools to early detection of kidney problems and for testing therapy. Thank you very much for your kind listening.
I got it. يلا وين ثوبنا احنا؟